Baby Doe was a child that was born in Bloomington, Indiana, and it had two things wrong with it. Its esophagus ended right here, and so it couldn't swallow. And the esophagus that joins the stomach, instead of hooking onto the upper esophagus, went into the windpipe. So the child was exposed to pneumonia by swallowing its own saliva into its lungs and by having gastric juices, which are acid, come up and go down in the lung as well. The second thing the child had was Down syndrome, and the obstetrician who delivered that baby knew nothing about either. And he told these poor little parents that, first of all, their child would be a blob, and he had no right to say that, and there's no statistics to indicate that. The way a Down syndrome child grows in our society depends upon how much the society puts into that child. And he also said that the mortality for the operation to fix the esophagus was better than 50%. Now, I was a pediatric surgeon, and I probably had operated on more baby does than anybody in the world. And yet nobody in the government ever asked me what I thought about it at all. And this thing all took place around me, and suddenly we had a crisis on our hands with a doctor who didn't know what he was doing, a judge who didn't know what he was doing, making the decision that the family could do what they wanted to do, and they, of course, having a blob with an operative mortality of 50%, said, we don't want our child to be operated upon. I should just tell you that my operative mortality for the previous 8 years in a full-term baby like that was zero. Mm. And no reason why that child couldn't have been successfully operated upon and properly raised. The child died on the 15th day, and President Reagan said he never wanted to see that happen again on his watch. And machinery was put into place that was improper. There were signs put up in hospitals that made parents suspicious of doctors and nurses. And of course, when they were sued by the AMA and the American Academy of Pediatrics and all those people, and who did they call for their expert witness to defend them was C.E. Koop. And we lost that case, as we should have. Mm-hmm. And they immediately tried another set of rules, not quite as stringent, but still onerous. And we lost that case as well. And they were getting ready to do the third set of rules and regulations. And I went to Margaret Heckler, who was the Secretary of HHS. And I said, if you...
Excuse me, would you just tell for our audience, HHS means...
Health and Human Services. It's a cabinet department. It used to be Health, Education, and Welfare, then Health and Human Services. And if I had my way, there would be a health department here and a human services department here. We are the only country in the world that doesn't have a man in the cabinet who is dedicated to health alone, mm-hmm. and we need it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Sorry okay. for the interruption.
So I went to Margaret Heckler and I said, if you expect me to be the expert witness to defend the government, I want to write the rules and regulations. Mm-hmm. Seems reasonable, she said, and so I did. I accomplished that. We sat around a table five times as big as this, and people who were enemies began to work together. We wrote something called the Patient's Bill of Rights for newborn infants. And it was one of the best times of my life to see how you could bring people together. Now, we were still sued, and we still lost the case. But in the meantime, Ted Kennedy, senator from Massachusetts, lifted the whole problem of Baby Doe out of the problems of handicapped children and put it in the child abuse situation. So that took care of itself, but it stands as a landmark case of infanticide. And it had a lot to do with the life I had led before. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether you plan to get into this, but before I went to Washington, I had written a book with Francis Schaeffer mm-hmm. and made 5 one-hour movies with him. And the first three films were abortion, infanticide, and euthanasia. And the other two were Christian answers to those dilemmas. And another thing that I presume your audience doesn't know is that Ronald Reagan was one of the few presidents that ever wrote a book while he was in office. And if you don't believe that there are conspiracies among newspapers and publishers, I don't think that the fact that he wrote that book is known, but I also know that it was sold millions of copies, never appeared on a bestseller list, but the book had three chapters. The first chapter was by the president himself on abortion. It was called Abortion and the Right of a Nation. The second was a chapter by me on infanticide, Baby Doe stuff, mm-hmm. and I called it The Slide to Auschwitz. And the third chapter was on euthanasia and was written by Malcolm Muggeridge, former atheist, former editor of Punch magazine in England, and now a solid Christian and certainly a stellar pro-life advocate. Mm-hmm. But there's an example. You can't find that book anyplace mm-hmm. today. It's really a collector's mm-hmm. item, but it was buried by the publishing industry mm-hmm. because they didn't like the content. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, part of the whole Baby Doe controversy, at least in terms of the conservatives that arose, came with this notion of patient care committees in hospitals. Mm-hmm. Could you help me understand why that would create a controversy and impugn your reputation as a pro-life doctor?
Well, up until Baby Doe, the situation was between the doctor and the family, and the baby, of course, was the object of their concern. What the two initial laws that were struck down and mine provided for was a reasonable group of people who met and talked over the pros and cons. And what we did was to determine under what circumstances you could even think that it's better to kill a child than to let it live. And we ended up in that morass of the word futility. And we said that it is always necessary to save the life of a child unless the operative procedure, for example, would be considered futile. And one of the best things that happened, and again, that the world doesn't know about, while this was all going on, President Reagan had appointed a commission on biomedical ethics. And they had concluded that if you had a child with Down syndrome, it was perfectly okay to assume that that would not be a sufficiently normal child that a family would want to raise, which is not true either. And it was perfectly okay, therefore, not to feed that child. And I went to the chairman of that committee, and I said, let's not talk about a baby doe. Let's talk about you. Suppose you suddenly are hit by a car, and you're lying in a bed in the hospital, and they say, you know, his head is damaged. He's had some problems with his digestive tract because of the way he was hit. And if he recovers, he's not going to have all the marbles he had before. He may not be able to use his bladder. He probably will not be able to walk without crutches. The question, sir, is do we save your life or do we not? And he went back and changed the whole report to the president and said that any defective child was entitled to every single thing that a normal child was. And that was a tremendous victory.
Mm-hmm. So the patient care committees then, did that ever end up coming into fruition?
They still exist. Uh-huh. Most hospitals have an ethical patient care committee, and they function in two ways. If you were a doctor and you wanted to do a clinical study on 40 patients for some reason or other, you would have to pass your protocol around that uh-huh. committee, and they would have to say, no harm will be done. This will benefit the children that are being tested, and in the long run will benefit other children that know nothing about mm-hmm. this. And for an individual case, you would decide whether or not there was sufficient reason not to proceed as you would with a normal child. And if so, you would have to defend it very strongly. Mm-hmm. Now, those boards and hospitals do not function with the same accuracy that they did right mm-hmm. after they were committed, because all things tend to fade away. Mm-hmm. But it changed the way we mm-hmm. were thinking, and this rapid slide that I called the slide to Auschwitz was stopped. Mm.